Well, I'd like to begin by thanking Manush for inviting me here. And so the topic of the talk today is quantum dynamics with stochastic resets. And this is a work that we did with my collaborator, Shatta Majumdar from Orsay France, and Bhaskar Mukherjee, my student at ICTS Kolkata. And this is the reference in case you guys are interested. So first, here is the outline of the talk. So first, I'm going to motivate why we study this, why we sort of took up this study, and talk a bit about formalism, and then show that this formalism could be applied to quantum quenches. That's the out of equilibrium part. And study what kind of non-integrable, for non-integrable models, what kind of steady states one gets when one applies this dynamics protocol to an arbitrary non-integrable system. So, and I'm going to sort of numerically demonstrate that our formalism gives this results by applying this protocol to some well-known cold atom system, which I'm going to introduce. Then talk a bit about integrable models, which should be somewhat in line with the topic of the conference here. And in particular, I'm going to talk about the nature of correlation function of periodically driven integrable models in the presence of this reset protocol. Okay, so this would be followed by conclusion. So motivation. So why are you doing this? Well, you know, there are several recent studies on reset dynamics in classical systems. And so the question they ask is the following. So let us consider a general classical system evolving under its own dynamics. And now consider interruption of such dynamics at random times during which the system is reset to some initial condition. So for example, if it's a particle moving in some with some stochastic dynamics, what you mean by reset is to just bring the particle back at its position, for example, at the initial time. So, and now you let the system evolve again. So the question is, what happens to the system at long times under such dynamics? And what they found, and this is a work by Shatta Majumdar and Martin Evans back in 2011, what they found is that leads to realization of non-trivial stationary states, and there are other applications of this in several processes, which I'm going to briefly mention. Okay. So here is a very simple example. And consider just a single particle diffusing in one dimension with a diffusion constant d. And this is being reset to its original position, which is this x0, at arbitrary random times tau. Okay. And this tau is a random time, and it has a particular distribution. So the equation of probability of finding the particle at any point x and t, this probability distribution, is the usual diffusion equation. And then this reset is introduced through these fluxes. So there is a flux of bringing back. So there is a negative flux of having the particle at any other position with amplitude r, and a positive flux of it having it being at x equal to x0, which is how you introduce the reset. And you can do some calculation with this. It's not that difficult, but I'm not going to go through this. And you can show that the stationary distribution for this dynamics, which in the absence of the reset would have been a Gaussian, is now an exponential of the following form. And this alpha naught is controlled by the reset rate r. Now, why is it important or interesting? So first of all, you know, there is something in statistical classical statistical mechanics called the fast passage problem. And the question you ask there is that what is the mean fast passage time for a particle to hit a target during its evolution? So, yeah.
So what do you do with the momentum? When you reset,
just reset the position in this classical.
Just position.
Yeah, and then let it evolve again. You know, so in these problems, so you sort of ask for that this thing that what's the, since it's a diffusion problem, you could ask that what's the mean fast passage time for a particle to hit a target during its evolution. And for a single diffusive particle, say that the target was put at origin and you started from a finite coordinate, x0 greater than 0, the diffusive system with no reset, it's known that the mean fast passage time is actually infinite. It diverges. I mean, the system really doesn't reach the origin at all. And in a reset average dynamics, if you calculate this mean fast passage time, you see that there is a finite fast passage time. and which diverges as 1 over square root of r in for small reset rate, which essentially gives you this infinite time without the reset. And it also diverges when r becomes very large. And that's just to say that if you keep on resetting the particle very fast, it never has the time to evolve and therefore doesn't reach the dynamics. But in between, somewhere this time is maximized, and therefore you can get an optimal reset rate which leads to the fastest fast passage time. Okay, so that's the idea. So one can find this in this simple example. But this can be, there are several other applications. So for example, this fast passage time is can give rise to efficient search algorithms for multi-particle systems. So you find a particular object in a given configuration space. It can give rise to novel stationary states, something that I demonstrated for this, this really simple system. And it can also lead to novel stochastic thermodynamics and fluctuation theorems, something that I'm not entirely familiar with, but there are lots of papers on the subject. But the question that I want to ask in this talk is completely different, is that suppose I have a quantum system where there is unitary time evolution, okay, as governed by some Schrodinger equation, and I interrupt this with random stochastic resets, where at each reset, at a random time tau, the system is reset to its initial state. The question is, what do I get? Okay, so if this is done for a many-body system, and if the system reaches a steady state, is that steady state different from the usual unitary evolution steady state that we have? So that's the question that I'm going to ask. So let me just talk a bit about the formalism. So first, let me try to explain what do we mean by reset average quantum dynamics in this context. So there are actually two equivalent ways of thinking about this averaging over resets. So the first thing is that ensemble average. So what we can do is that we can take a quantum system, make n copies of it, and let each of the copies evolve according to some dynamics, which is governed by its Hamiltonian, and starting from the same initial condition. Now, for each copy, let us assume that an observer makes a measurement after a random time tau, and then he just let go. Okay, he or she doesn't look at the system anymore. And the time tau is a random number drawn from a probability distribution, and I'm going to derive this probability distribution in a moment. Then one averages over all these measurements. So this n observers just submits their data sheet to you in this and then you just want to see what the reset average is by summing over data from these measurements, okay? And it turns out, and this is again something that I'm going to demonstrate, both numerically and analytically, that for large number of these n copies, the system reaches a steady state, and we are going to study this steady state. And what I mean by when the system reaches this steady state is that after you have taken n measurements and averaged over that, you take the result of the n plus 1th measurement, add that to the system, and the result is going to remain the same. So it's really a steady state. But there is an equivalent way of looking into this problem, which is in the sense of a time average. Now consider a single and not n copies of a system and let it evolve. So again, after some random time tau, after which the system makes an unitary evolution, the observer, and there is an observer which makes its first measurement, and immediately after this measurement, one resets the system to the initial state. Okay? The measurement might change the state of the system and do something to the system, but we are not concerned with that. We just reset it to the initial state right after the measurement. And this process is repeated, and the system evolves in time in this manner for a total time small t. And again, what we are going to show is that for a large t, the system receives a steady state. And these two steady states are one and the same. And because each of this evolution is uncorrelated, so making n copies of this quantum system and making n time evolution essentially gives you the same result. This is something that we numerically checked for a model, but it's kind of, not too difficult to assume from here. So since each of this unitary time evolution in this time average picture is independent, it doesn't depend on the last evolution, it's equivalent to making n copies of the system, and therefore the time average is equivalent to ensemble average. Yeah. Uh, Yeah, some random time tau. No. So the point is, when I have this random time tau, I have n copies of the system. So I've made n observers, I've made n measurements, and then you just sum this up. Not one, but n. Yeah, sure. Yeah, I'm just weighing according to a distribution. That's right. Yeah, sure. That's the meaning of taking the. Yeah. That's right. Coming up. Yeah, coming up. Just wait. So, okay. So here is the quantum system. So imagine that I have a quantum system, and let's first consider the system in the absence of reset. So we know that there is a unitary evolution operator which takes the system from time, let's say, 0 to t. Now, in the presence of reset, here is the dynamic. So I know the wave function has evolved up to a time t, and then at time t plus dt, it goes to its initial state with a probability r dt. That's the reset probability within that interval. And with a probability 1 minus r dt, it just evolves accord by this unitary evolution operator. And if dt is small, which you could just say that this is your evolution operator. So the system either undergoes a reset with probability r dt or undergoes a Hamiltonian evolution with probability 1 minus r dt. And then we want to, our goal is to, so for example, compute the density matrix of the system at time t, which is the final, after averaging over all such results. So that's what we are going to do. To do this, we first need to find the probability of distribution of these resets, and that's what we're going to do. And to this end, we note that a reset is a Poisson process characterized by a rate r, which means that the probability that there will be no reset up to a particular measurement time t is exponential of minus rt. And thus the probability that there will be at least one reset is 1 minus that. And this tells you that I can define a probability distribution function which integrated from 0 to t is going to give me 1 minus e to the power minus rt. And that gives you that there is at least one reset. So the total probability distribution is this piece out here plus the probability distribution of having no reset within a time tau. Okay. So you just add these two, and that's your probability. You can check that if you integrate this over all times, you essentially find one, which is the normalization of the probability distribution. So the point is that the last term, which gives the probability of no reset till t, vanishes exponentially with increasing time t, and this is why the system reaches a steady state, which we are going to see. So now imagine that I have a density matrix of some sort evolving like this at any up in any random time tau, given that the measurement time is t. And therefore, at time t, the reset average density matrix would be just the integral of this with the probability distribution that I just wrote down. So it has one piece, which is this integral of this out here. And the second piece, which is the probability that it is evolved unitarily through the entire time t, and there is no reset. But if I now make this final measurement time to be very, very large, which is equivalent to measuring large n naught copies, then this term goes away, okay, because it's exponentially suppressed for any finite r. And then we are left with a stationary state density matrix, which is completely independent of the measurement time t, and also, it's a real steady state. Now the question is, once you have this, is this density matrix interesting in any sense? Or, is there something? So to do this, we took the simplest possible thing where we tried to study the reset dynamics following quantum quench. Now here quench is used such that I get a state which is not diagonal in the energy basis of the Hamiltonian, the beginning state, it will have some distribution. So that's all I want. So imagine, so first let me digress a little bit and talk about a steady state following a quantum quench where there is no reset. Okay, it's completely unitary evolution. Now, consider the time evolution of a quantum system. So I have a state psi naught, which is my beginning state, which was my original ground state just before the quench. And now I have quenched the Hamiltonian parameter, so that's not a ground state in the final energy Hamiltonian basis anymore. So essentially, in the final Hamiltonian's eigenbasis, that is the energy eigenbasis out here, it has a distribution. So, and those distribution is characterized by this coefficient C alpha, which gives you the overlap of the alpha-th energy eigenstate with the initial state. So now I can write down the density matrix. That's straightforward. So at any time t, this rho alpha beta, the matrix element of density matrix between any two states alpha and beta is just this. Okay. Now you keep doing this time average, and if this system reaches a steady state, then I know that in this state, average of alpha, that's the time average of this rho alpha beta, the long time average of this, just gives you diagonal terms. And that's because, and that's your diagonal ensemble. So for non-integrable systems, this is almost always the density matrix when you reach a steady state. Okay, so it's only diagonal terms. And any expectation value of any operator O is given by this, it's traced with the diagonal density matrix in the steady state. Okay, and this is what we call as OD, you know, the diagonal value of the O. This also signifies complete loss of phase information of the initial state, because that phase information is hidden in this relative phases of the C alpha and C betas. And apparently, if only the diagonal matrices contribute, then this phase information is not there. And so what has happened is that, you know, this loss of the, so because the off-diagonal elements go to zero in the steady state, you lose all initial phase information. And you say that the system is thermalized, and this is one of the thermal density matrix, steady state density matrix. Now let us do the same thing with resets. So what happens is that now I have an initial wave function, which can once again be written like this. One now tracks the density matrix evolution. It evolves unitarily for random times tau, and then followed by measurement and immediate reset. Or you can make n copies and do the ensemble thing. Between any two resets, the density matrix is given by this, which is again the same thing, because it's just evolving according to some Hamiltonian. But now the reset average steady state is given by the following integral. So I just have to average it over some standard reset distribution. As a result, what happens is that I have non-zero values of the off-diagonal elements. Okay, the diagonal elements remains exactly the same because they don't depend on time, and the reset average basically gives you the same value. So this gives rise to a steady state density matrix which retains its off-diagonal elements. And and I guess this is not too hard to imagine, because this has information from all length of time evolution, and you know, so it retains off-diagonal matrix elements. So what are the points? So first is that the steady state density matrix has finite off-diagonal elements. It's not a diagonal matrix element in the energy basis, and so this is not a thermal density matrix. Okay. It's characterized by a reset rate R, these off-diagonal elements, and therefore it has phase information. And because its coefficient is determined by this C alpha star C beta, etc., it has phase information of the initial state. So for R tending to zero, we get back the standard diagonal density matrix result. Okay, so this only has diagonal elements, the off-diagonal elements vanish, and you once again get the thermal steady state diagonal density matrix. But for really large R, we find that this quantity essentially goes back to the initial density matrix. That's because this factor goes to 1. So you just have rho 0. You know, that's your density matrix. And this is the manifestation of the Zeno effect, because you are resetting the system so fast that it's simply not evolving. And, you know, it just gives you back the original initial result. So this is a nice way of interpolating between the quantum Zeno result and the free unitary evolution result. And that's signified here. So one can also calculate the expectation value of a generic operator, which receives contribution from off-diagonal elements. And therefore, any of this is going to have a diagonal part, which is the thermal answer, you know, for the standard unitary evolution, plus some terms, which depends on all kinds of details and is proportional to the rate of reset. Okay, so these operators are not given by their diagonal or thermal value, and therefore the system doesn't thermalize under such dynamics. So you get back an athermal steady state. Now the question that comes is that, so suppose I have this, and you know, in all of this, I have assumed that I can reset the system to its initial condition exactly. Now the question is, what happens if you cannot do that if it's an imperfect reset? So this coefficient C alpha, sorry, this should be C alpha, is no longer determined by a single initial set. I mean, there could be randomness out there. So if the reset is completely random, C alphas can take all possible values, and when you average over them, this kind of coefficients averages over all alpha and beta, this is going to go to zero. And at the end of the day, you are going to get back your diagonal results anyway. Okay. However, this is the extreme case. Okay. A generic case, one expects the reset not to be completely random, and C alpha could have a peak distribution around a mean value. And if that happens, then the average of C alphas in such cases will lead to will keep this off-diagonal elements. Okay, it's going to give you a finite value of this off-diagonal elements. So this effect is robust at least against small imperfection in resetting. We haven't really studied this case in great details, but and for the rest of the talk, I'm going to just talk about perfect reset. But one thing that I wanted to sort of make a case for is that this is not one of those cases where you make the thing just a bit imperfect and the whole effect goes away. Okay. So it's more robust than that. So now I'm going to apply this to a concrete model, which is a tilted Bose-Savart model in an optical lattice, and see what we get there, you know, this whole thing. So to that end, let me just introduce this optical lattice thing, which is something that I worked on a long time back during my postdoc days. So the model is basically that of a bosonic chain, and then you apply a quote-unquote electric field on these neutral bosons. Now, applying electric field to some neutral particles might seem like a crazy thing to do or say, but the point is that this electric field is essentially applied in a slightly different way. So what happens is that these bosons in this bosonic chain there are two ways one can do it. One is that these things are confined in a trap, okay, and therefore they see a parabolic potential. So what one can do in experiments, and this is something that Emmanuel Bloch's group did in their seminal experiment in 2001, but I don't want to get into the details of this. So what they did is just shift the center of the trap. So once you do this, and because it's a harmonic trap, you generate a linear potential, which acts like a effective electric field for these bosons. The other thing that you could do is that these bosons typically often are have a spin, okay, or the total angular momentum F, which is equal to 1. So you could just put a magnetic field which is space dependent, and that's going to give you a Zener term, which could give you this electric field. So either way, you know, this is effectively like a bunch of bosons subjected to some applied electric field. This is not an electromagnetic electric field, so to speak, but the effect is the same. So, okay, so now once you apply this electric field, what do you expect? Well, if this was a classical problem, you would expect that all the bosons would eventually go to the end of the chain and pile up there, if these are non-interacting bosons. However, in quantum case, this doesn't happen because it's a lattice and there are Bloch oscillations. So if you think of this in the Bloch space, there are this, you know, so the electron goes up to the edge of the Brillouin zone and it's reflected in the other side. So it really doesn't accelerate. The other way to see is that if you have this non-interacting problem, this is a problem of a one-year start ladder, okay, and this can be exactly solved. And you see that the wave functions is exponentially, or actually more than exponentially localized at the position of the chain. So the bosons do not move. And as long as it's a single band problem, you know, there is no electrical breakdown within this thing. So for the electrical breakdown to happen, each of these lattices has single bands, I mean, multiple single band states, and you have to really go to the next band. And the time taken typically by the system to do that in this ultra-cold atom context is more than the system lifetime. So the strategy for tackling this kind of system, which is there in a metastable state for very long, is that one tries to capture the subspace which is resonantly coupled to this parent mod state, this n number of particles in a given site with an electric field, and see if there is, see what the nature of the excitation is. So to get this, we need to find out what are the low energy excitations of this system. Now, typically in a Bose-Savart model, you would have thought of adding a quasi-particle and a quasi-hole, and they eventually would destroy this most mod state. That's the not superfluid transition for you. However, here there is a problem. Once you apply, sort of add a quasi-particle, you know, it of course can hop from one side to another, and there is a typical hopping, effective hopping term for that. But there is also this electric field, okay? And this, again, is a one-year stuck problem, and it gives you localization, essentially. So this extra particle just stay where you put it, okay? It cannot really accelerate because of the presence of this electric field. As a result, what happens is that this charged excitation that is having a quasi-particle or quasi-hole essentially are not the low-energy excitations of the system, because you put it, you sort of, by putting it here, you are paying up an energy cost of the order of U. That's the interaction thing. But then they don't really move through the lattice to sort of make up for that energy cost. Okay, so they are always high energy in the spectrum. What are low energy excitations are the dipoles. So a boson can spontaneously hop to the next lattice, and that costs an electric field energy E. And so it gains an electric field energy E, and pays an energy U, which is this on-site interaction term, by doing this. And as a result, what happens is that these excitations, these dipole excitations, essentially cost an energy U minus E. So whenever this effective electric field is of the same order of magnitude as the boson repulsion U, you know, this becomes the low energy state. And in fact, if you, if you tune your electric field with through this U, that is, you make it larger than U, then you precipitate a phase transition out there. Okay, so this state, this parent Mohr state, becomes destabilized. So if I start from the parent Mohr state, and if I have this thing, so I can try to sort of describe this system within this small subspace by dipole, effective dipole Hamiltonian, okay, where this process where I destroy a boson at a site I and create it at site j is like creating a dipole. Okay, so in terms of this dipole operator, so you see that each of this dipole creation costs an energy U minus E, which I explained, and then because there is hopping in the problem, a boson can spontaneously just hop to the next site, you know, and therefore it can either create or destroy a dipole spontaneously, and therefore dipole number is not conserved. Now, there are two constraints with this model. One of them is that if you have formed a dipole here, that's it. You cannot really form the second dipole, because if you calculate the energy of formation, that is way up in the spectrum. And there is, you can also show, and I'm not going to get into the details of this, that the number of, so once you have formed dipoles on a given link between two sites, you really cannot form a dipole in the next link. I mean, that also, that state is also a high energy state, which is not a part of this resonant low energy part state. Okay. So now we are going to take this model and determine the phase diagram as a function of U minus E by tau. And so what happens in weak electric field? Your ground state is a dipole vacuum, and the fast excited state is basically creation of dipoles, and let me not get into the details of that. So, you know, that's your entire low energy spectrum. But the interesting thing is the strong electric field part, where your ground state is a ground state of maximal number of dipoles. Now, because of this constraint of not having dipoles in the neighboring sites, what happens is that you could form these dipoles only either on odd links, okay, or on even links, and therefore the ground state breaks the Z2 symmetry, okay. And breaking this Z2 symmetry means that this cannot be continuously connected to the zero dipole state. It's just like an Ising model in some sense. And so apparently it shows similar behavior to Ising model in a transverse field. And sure enough, that when we did some numerics on this exact diagonalization, we found that the transition between the two states belongs to the Ising universality class, and we could determine the value of E at which this transition occurs. Okay, so this model harbors it harbors an Ising transition, and the interesting part about this model is that without getting into the details of this, it has been observed by Emmanuel, this Marcus Greiner's group, in an experiment. So what happened is that they prepared this rubidium atoms, and they could make a optical lattice and put them there. So after the state is prepared, they when they want to measure, they freeze the motion of the atoms by increasing the lattice depth, and then they apply a light-assisted collision. So, and this collision, this is designed in such a way that if there are two or if any even number of bosons in a given optical lattice, what happens is that they could use this light to interact with each other and get out of the trap. Okay, so you lose these atoms. However, if there are odd numbers, there is at least one which is left. So if you image these atoms after this light-assisted collision, you find out either a black or a white, which essentially means that you are getting the parity of occupation of these bosons in any given lattice. That's how they measure. And so let me not get into this. And when they measure this parity of occupation, they could see that you go from an uniform boson state to 2020 configuration, which was a dipole maximum state. And this they found by varying their electric field, and they found a transition. It's not really a transition here because the chain size was pretty small. It's more like a crossover, but you could sort of get in between these two states reversibly. So you could go from one to the other and come back by just by varying this electric. No. So when they try the chain, they ramp up the optical lattice in the transverse direction so that there is no motion in the other. See, the original system is a 2D, but the optical lattice depth in one of the direction is very, very large. So it becomes essentially a bunch of 1D chains. Okay. So that's how they always do experiments with that. So now what I'm going to do is to sort of study this reset dynamics in this model. I mean, mainly because it's a nice model where numerics can be done, and also because the constraints essentially reduces the Hilbert space quite a bit. So you could do exact diagonalization very easily. And also this is, you know, a model which has been experimentally found, so why not? So essentially what we compute is the dipole density as a function of time. So if I just allow for uniform evolution, I start from a initial ground state which has zero dipole density, and then I do a quench where to a value of the electric field where the ground state has maximal dipoles, that's in the dipole state. So, and then I look at the evolution, and this, it's known that this particular model, you know, under standard circumstances would go to a steady state, and the value of this dipole density in that steady state is known. Now, two things. First is with reset dynamics, what we find is that as a function of R, this particular value, the large T value, or the steady state value, essentially goes all the way from 0.25, which is this number, to zero. And the reason is that if I am at very large reset rate, then the system essentially doesn't evolve, and I essentially have the old ground state, which means that the dipole density in that old ground state would be zero. And this is the steady state value for no reset, and in between it steadily decreases. Okay, and the distribution of this ND is also given here. Okay, so for large ND, essentially everything is clustered around, you know, this. This in R equal to zero, and here it's so here it has a distribution out here. Okay. So the second point that I want to make is that now with this concrete system, we can numerically check what is the ND as a function of N naught. That is the number of measurements. Number of measurements, and therefore you find that after around 1,000 measurements, everything is flat. We also checked, although I don't have the data here, we also checked for the variance, and that goes to zero. So we really reach a steady state. Okay, at least in this model, what we find is that we have a... So we also calculate the half-chain entanglement entropy, and that also essentially shows the same thing. And the other thing that we measure is the slope of this defect, the dipole density as a function of this reset rate, and that depends on R. So if you measure this at R, but this, so the point about this is that this, the value of this depends on the number of states that prepare that participates in this sum, and that essentially becomes large when you are close to a critical point, and therefore this peak as a function of u minus e by tau. And the and this one can explain, but let me just not do this very clearly. I can always discuss this with if you are interested. But the point is that so this essentially shows that the steady state that we have in this non-integrable models as a function in presence of this reset dynamics is quite different from the standard ones. Okay. So now I'm going to talk about the integrable models, and okay. So the first thing that we studied is a simple fermionic chain. Okay, and that's a problem that has been studied by several groups in the past. And essentially for the reason that it can be exactly solved. Okay, and this is one of the simplest thing that one can do. So you have a chain and you come up with an initial state where all the fermions are in the left half of the chain. And this is at x equal to zero, it's completely empty on the other side. And then you let this chain, the fermions in the chain evolve according to the simplest possible Hamiltonian that you can think of, which is just this hopping. Okay. And sure enough that there is an exact solution out here. So the operator, the fermionic operator at any time t can be written in terms of the fermionic operator at any time zero times some Bessel functions. And more interestingly, this fermion density can be written in terms of this Bessel functions, where this k involves all sides from m to infinity, where m is greater than zero in this case. Okay, so this formula applies to the right half of the chain and tells you what the density distribution is at a time t on the mth side, where m is greater than zero. And to obtain this, obtain the density at a site which is at the left half of the chain, which is m less than zero in my notation, you could just use this. This is an exact symmetry of the problem. Okay, so I don't want to get into the details. There are several papers on this. But the interesting thing about this is that if you look at the density profile, you know, in large time times, it's given by a scaling function. Okay, and this scaling function is known. So that's the dynamics without any kind of reset. So what happens when you do this reset? So you know this nm of tau, which is just this jk square over tau, and you do a reset average. So a few things. The first is that the expected behavior is seen here. So if your reset rate is really large, all the fermions occupying the left half of the chain, so here yellow means 1 and blue means 0. Okay, let's just keep it that way. So you see that when as the reset rate increases, the region over which this transition takes place, that's the region where over which the density profile is changing, shrinks. Okay, and so if you really go to large R, this is going to be a initial distribution where it would be like a step function. And as you decrease R, you know, this thing essentially sort of, you know, proliferates. I mean, the region over which there is a change in the distribution. And if you really go to R equal to zero, you are going to find a half for each site. And that's the final state, stationary state, right? Where the system is not going to evolve anymore. And this is something we find from the scaling function. Here, what we find, without getting into the mathematical details of it, is that density profile for fermions at small r and large m, that is large site index and small reset rate, for a fixed x, which is the product of the two, is essentially a scaling function, which is given by this simple formula, where this is a modified Bessel function of the second kind. And so if you put x equal to zero, this integral could be exactly done, and one can show that f0 is half. Okay. That's the distribution for large, that's the distribution for small reset rate, actually reset rate going to zero, which is same as the evolution without reset. And for large x, it's exponentially decaying, which means that it's going to be, its deviation from the initial distribution is going to be exponentially suppressed. And this also matches with numerics. Okay, so we checked that this is actually the thing. So this scaling function is something which is different from the standard scaling function without the reset. And finally, let me try to talk a little bit about these integrable models, the other class of integrable models that I wanted to talk about. And that's this free fermionic models in D dimensions. And these are two component fermions with creation and destruction operators. So there is a tuning parameter in this model. And this is, so I'm going to now study periodic drive of this stuff. And this is going to be periodically driven with some protocol. And these Pauli matrices typically are matrices in particle Hull space. And of course, Hamiltonian, this Hamiltonian that we choose is not arbitrary. It, you know, it, there are many systems which essentially gives you this Hamiltonian, including Ising model in D equal to 1, Kitaev model in D equal to 2, and Dirac fermions, which just has quasi particles in various systems. Okay, so that's a standard model there. So what we want to do is to study the reset dynamics of H when the periodic drive, characterized by the number of periods n and frequency omega, is interrupted after a random integer number of periods. So you let the system evolve for n periods and then reset. Okay, and then again n prime periods and reset, where n is a random integer. So So typically, in this kind of evolution, what is important is the Fluke Hamiltonian of the system, since I am making stroboscopic measurements. That is, I measure the, any properties of the system only after n periods of the drive, okay, where n is an integer. And this Fluke Hamiltonian for these integrable models can be computed, it can be computed exactly, and one can even have analytic expression for this for certain type of protocols. But without getting into the details of this mathematics, let me just point out is that we can find out this Fluke energy, that is, and the Fluke Hamiltonian quite so exactly, and provided we choose a square pulse or a kicked periodic kicks, we can actually find out exact expressions for these thetas and phis, and we can sort of get the Hamiltonian analytically. Okay, so what are these thetas and phis? These thetas and phis are essentially the thing that is used. So these are parameters which leads to parameterization of the unitary evolution operator, and they can be, their expressions can be found in terms of the initial and the final wave function of the system after a period of evolution. Now, what do we want to do with this? We want to calculate the correlation functions of the model, okay? And these correlation functions, there are just two independent correlation functions because these are integrable models of this kind. And this essentially can be written in terms of these parameters of the Fluke Hamiltonian, okay? So remember that we had this, so this n is basically epsilon divided by mod epsilon. So n1 is epsilon k1 divided by mod epsilon k, okay? So in terms of these models, so if I calculate this correlation after n periods of the drive, and this is dynamics without any reset, what I find is that there is a piece which gives me the value of these correlations in the steady state limit, which is the GGE value. And then there is a piece which vanishes as n goes to infinity. Okay, so we are going to call this piece delta C of k. Okay, and this piece out here as delta f of k. So these correlations are c, which is this piece, which is the GGE value, and then there are some delta c and delta f. So all elements of the correlation function can be expressed in terms of the Fluke Hamiltonian. Okay, so that's a thing that you can do for this kind of models. Now the point is that when can I say that, so now I'll study this reset dynamics, and provided that these pieces, this delta C and delta F, gives me a finite number, then I can clearly say that the correlation function due to reset dynamics is different in the steady state, is different from that of the unitary evolution, right? Because this unitary evolution piece is independent of n, because it's n tending to infinity limit, and therefore my random choice of n doesn't really influence this part, okay? So if these things are finite in the presence of reset dynamics, then I have correlation functions which are different, and this is a signature that you have a different generalized Gibbs ensemble which is characterized by a reset rate R, and that's what we are going to show. So what do we do now? We take these values of delta C and delta F, which is just this, what I showed in the last slide, And then we let the system evolve till some random number of cycles before a reset. And this is chosen from this distribution N. That's a familiar distribution. We could choose any, actually. So you could choose any distribution and then average over it. But this is just a choice that I used. And what we find is that this delta CK, it can be exactly calculated in terms of these parameters. And it is indeed different from, it's different from zero. So there is a deviation of this delta C from its zero value. So essentially, the correlation function of this reset average dynamics is different from that of the unitary evolution, which probably means that the GG reached at finite R due to this reset dynamics is different from the standard unitary evolution GG, and you have a family of them depending on the parameter R, okay, used to characterize your probability distribution. Okay, so let me try to summarize. So what we have done is we have studied quantum dynamics interrupted by stochastic reset, leading to, and we found that this leads to interesting steady and stationary states. For non-integrable systems, such states are generally athermal. Okay, there are off-diagonal elements of the density matrix, and the density matrix at long times is not the diagonal density matrix. There is no thermalization in these systems under these dynamics. So they provide a natural, also this kind of dynamics provides a natural interpolation between unitary dynamics without reset and the quantum Zeno limit of a generic quantum system. For integrable models such as fermion chains in 1D, they give rise to a novel stationary state distribution. And for periodically driven Dirac models, it leads to presence of lots of EGs. So, okay, so and this last statement is something I don't really know, but ultracold atoms may serve as a platform for studying such dynamics. Since these systems, and particularly specific atoms, have been studied to study quantum Zeno effect, which is one extreme case of this reset dynamics. Okay. Not going to get into the details of the of those experimental systems. So thank you for your attention, and I stop here.
Okay, let's thank Krishnendu again. Questions?
How much your result depend on the choice of the resetting distribution? In the first case, you chose an exponential distribution?
No, first case, we derived an exponential distribution. As long as the initial rate is Poisson, the rest is fixed.
Poisson and exponential distribution are related.
But, so, okay, so let me address this in the context of this periodically driven model.
In the case of periodically, you took Poisson. Right?
No, we didn't. So that Poisson was an arbitrary choice. See, I am trying to choose a number, n, randomly, and I'm going to sort of allow the system to evolve until that, and then again. So here we just randomly choose. So there are, so in the, okay, in this work that we have on the archive, we studied different distribution, and what we could find is that in two or three distributions that we studied, in each case, the steady state is different. Although the exact expression for the correlation function for the steady states are going to be different, but the fact that this steady state or the correlation function, this delta C's essentially, are non-zero, that stays.
So let's take an extreme case. If I take n equal to r.
N equal to r.
Yeah, you took a Poisson, which would mean r, 1 over r.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So now I just decide to take n equal to r, a delta distribution.
Yeah.
And they will be non-zero also.
If you are taking a delta function distribution.
Yeah, just
is that, sorry, I don't understand the distribution that you are taking. Is it delta function of delta of nr?
Yes.
Yeah, sure. Then you just.
I mean, you took a Poisson which is peaked at r.
Right.
I could also.
You could.
Delta.
Take a, that's and taking this, the no, but that's taking the r tending to infinity. See, that's taking the r tending to infinity limit of this, which will always give you the quantum Zeno stuff.
Okay. Now you have a parameter, but if I just decide to take n equal to
You could, and then you are going
it
to get.
It will be non-vanishing too, for
that's right.
Reason.
Yeah, that's right.
Now you take a slight, you put some variance on it. But
And then you are going to get this stuff. But the point is that for the standard unitary evolution, you know, that distribution, see, you reset with, reset typically in this kind of models, what we have studied is a Poisson process. And once you start, allow for that, the distribution is fixed.
Yeah, because you see that you have
independent. Yeah, right. And so the distribution is not really arbitrary in that part of the.
More questions?
Yeah, Vishak, you can shout.
All are distributed. Like you reset at very long times or something.
This will give rise to some other dynamics.
I mean, is it possible that you don't get a steady state if it's really, I mean, is there a chance, I mean, possibility of that, or you always get a steady state?
So you see, the point is that this steady state that, So this steady state that we have found is just for this Poisson process. I haven't studied the other steady states. I don't really know, but that can be studied in principle. I mean, I don't know the answer to. For the first case, so basically for the first case, what happens is that if you have P of R, you know, that's to be derived from the fact, and the what we use is that the system evolves, and then within the time interval dt, there is a probability R dt that it, you know, goes to this thing. And that is a Poisson process. And then once you have that, then the PDF, the probability distribution function, is fixed. Now, the question is that you could say that, well, why that? You know, you could do this in some other way. I don't know what will happen, but this is sort of the most natural choice. I mean, so.
More questions? If not, let's thank Krishnendu again.